Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to Encounter Today. What is God's word for you right now? What is he saying? What is he speaking to you? What is he speaking to your family? What is he saying to the church? Man lives not by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Father. And God has a fresh, hot word for you right now. And you're going to learn how to operate in that prophetic word tonight. You're going to learn how to operate in his anointing. And honestly, this is a message for everybody. I need to make that really clear before we dive into it. It doesn't matter who you are, male, female, what nation you live in, this is a message for you. And our guest tonight has a powerful anointing and gifting that's going to speak directly into your life. But before I introduce her, I want you to introduce yourself. Right there in the comments, I want you to let me know where are you watching from and what are you believing God for. Put your prayer request in there and we're going to stand in faith with you and believe God with you. Well, listen, I've been digging into a book here that I don't know that I would have run across if a Holy Ghost-filled, fire-baptized person didn't put this in my hand and say, you need to read this. And boy, did I ever need to read this, because our guest is not only a prophetically powerful, anointed speaker and teacher in the body of Christ, she's a prolific author, and she's written a book called The Deborah Company. It is a prophetic call to women to fulfill their divine destiny. But what I've discovered, this book is not for women. All of us need this in order to fulfill God's divine destiny on our life. Would you welcome to the program Jane Hamon to Encounter Today? Jane, it's such a pleasure to have you.
It is my honor to be here with you today. I'm very excited.
This is one, I have to be honest with you, and really before I dug into the book, our good friend Tina Pugh from Destiny Image sent this to me. I received the book, and before I even cracked it, I think I said to my wife, this is big. This is big. This is really important. Not just a book, but us connecting with you and this interview that we're going to do with you. I want everybody watching just to begin to pray in the Holy Spirit, because this is going to be a word specifically for you. Before I get into the book, you've shared a word for the church that's recently been disseminated about the battle that we're facing right now in this nation and around the world. And you specifically said that this is a battle for your voice. Yeah. Can you take me to the moment where you received that word, the context of it, and what's God saying to us right now?
Absolutely. I actually had a dream, and the Lord speaks to me quite a bit through dreams and through visions. And I had a dream a number of years ago, well, just a few years ago. And in the dream, I saw a reformer, and I was kind of watching the dream, and I saw this reformer be attacked. I was kind of having a vision in my dream, and I saw this attack coming that wanted to take the reformer out. And he kind of captured the reformer, stripped the shirt off his back, spread this poison on his back, and took a metal rod and began to beat him with this. And I knew that it was to silence the voice of the reformer, or to silence the voice of reformation, the voice of the Lord into the church. And in the dream, when I saw that happening, I went and I got the authorities, and they lay in wait for this attacker. And when he came, they captured him, took him outside, stripped the shirt off of his back, and took the rod out of his hand and put it into the hand of the reformer. And the reformer beat his back. I'm sorry if that's a little too graphic for some of you. Welcome to my dream life. But what was interesting is that this attacker's name in the dream, I knew his name was Rabshakeh. And so when I woke up from the dream, I was thinking, what is Rabshakeh? Is this like the name of a reggae band, or you know, what is this? Pizza or whatever. Mm-hmm. But as I looked into the scripture, I found that Rabshakeh really started speaking to me about the times that we're living in right now. And Rabshakeh was the emissary of Sennacherib. Sennacherib was probably one of the most cruel, violent kings in the ancient times. And he went through and he wiped out a bunch of the apostate Israeli communities leading up to Jerusalem at the time of Hezekiah. And Hezekiah, we know, was a phenomenal reformer that restored worship. He restored the law. He was bringing the people into the present truth move of the Spirit. And he laid siege to Jerusalem. And then he sent Rabshakeh out, who was his mouthpiece. So if you will, the voice of the devil. And Rabshakeh filled the air, filled the atmosphere with all kinds of accusations, with all kinds of intimidations. And he would say things like, there's no way you're going to win. You might as well give up. Your leader's not going to save you. Don't think your God is going to save you. Wow. And he just relentlessly bombarded the atmosphere over Jerusalem with these words. And in the story, you can read it, is that that Hezekiah goes and he lays these accusations before the Lord on the altar and begins to cry out in intercession. And at that moment, Isaiah comes and says, listen, King, I've got a word from the Lord for you. And he began to decree not one arrow of the enemy would come into Jerusalem, but that God would fight their battles for them. And that night, God sent one angel down and wiped out 185,000 Assyrians. Now, what the Lord spoke to me is that the enemy has been trying to fill the atmosphere with his voice, with his fake news, if you will. God's not going to save you. God's not going to deliver you. You might as well quit. You might as well give up. You don't believe the word of the Lord. Don't believe what God has said over your life. And I believe the enemy has been relentless in his attack of trying to attack people's minds. I think he's used just the voice of the enemy. I think he's used the media. I think he's used every force that he had available to try to bombard the minds and the hearts. That's like spreading that green poison on the back of the individual and then beating him. And when in the dream, you know, you look at the scripture and you see this amazing, amazing verse that comes out of Isaiah 30:31. And it says this, the voice of the Lord will shatter the Assyrian, or the voice of the Lord will shatter the enemy. With his scepter, he will strike them down. Every stroke the Lord lays on the back of the enemy with his punishing rod, there's the rods in the dream, will be to the music of tambourines and harps as he fights them in battle with the blows of his arm. So what we, the body of Christ, have to do is we've got to rise up, let the voice of the Lord be in our mouth more than any other voice during this season of time. I mean, we're in a time of unprecedented shaking in the earth, and we must allow the voice of the Lord to be preeminent in our minds, in our hearts. We've got a warfare with the prophetic word that God has spoken over our lives, and we've got to worship, because it is through the voice of the Lord and through worship that we see the enemy struck down. And all of those words, those relentless words that have been battling against our mind, we see those words struck down and we hear the voice of the Lord prevail in our hearts and our minds. So I believe it's a key time. We cannot just be sitting back and saying, well, let's see what happens. I believe that there's a besiegement that the enemy has set in motion, and that the answer is the voice of the Lord will shatter the enemy. Or as in Psalms 29:4, it tells us the voice of the Lord is powerful. It is a force that begins to break things open. So I believe it's a key time for us to tune our ear to the voice of God, for us to align our hearts in worship, and then watch God come and fight for us.
Wow. I want everybody that's listening to this, watching this, to write down in your notes, put it in the comments, the voice of the Lord will shatter the enemy. That is a word for every single one of you that are watching this right now. And you mentioned something else, that we must fill our mouth with the word of the Lord and with worship. There seems to be a worship revolution that's taking place, a militarization of our worship. Have you seen that? And talk to us a little bit about what that means.
Absolutely. You know, when you look in the scripture, you see so many different instances where God actually utilized worship as the key weapon of warfare. I mean, we look at the story of Jehoshaphat and sending the praisers out before the army. And I personally think that this decade we're in is aligning with 2 Chronicles 20:20, when it talks about believe the Lord, you'll be established, believe the prophets, you'll prosper. But for this year, the verse 2 Chronicles 20:22 says that as they began to sing and to praise the Lord set ambushments against their enemies, and they were defeated. And so we see that sound is a weapon, worship is a weapon, decreeing the word of the Lord is a weapon, saying what God says. Job chapter 22, verse 28 says, you shall decree a thing and it will be established for you, so light will shine on your way. So if you feel like you're facing a place of darkness, I'm telling you, when we decree what God has said, it causes light to shine. It causes our enemy to be defeated. It causes the darkness to be scattered. And when it says you shall decree a thing, what that word thing in Hebrew actually means is you shall decree the word, you shall decree the promise, or you shall decree the prophecy. So what has God said to you? Let that come out of your mouth. It can't just be in your heart. You have to actually engage in this voice war and let your voice and the voice of the Lord be louder than the voice of the enemy. And through your praise, God will actually cause that to happen. One scripture I want to give you is Psalms 8:2, which in the New King James will say something like, out of the mouth of babes and infants, you've ordained strength, I think is what it says. Mm-hmm. But if you go to the NIV, it actually says it this way. Out of the mouth of babes and infants, you've ordained praise because of your enemies to silence the foe and to still the avenger. Mm-hmm. So let's be clear. Honestly, God doesn't need our praise. He's got angels surrounding his throne 24/7. Okay, it is not about him that he has given us praise. He knew that praise would be our weapon, and that as we put praise in our mouth, then we would start saying what God said, and we would start seeing the enemy defeated.
It's so key and so practical what you're sharing too. And I think people that are watching this, you may have a moment here where you're going to have to lift your voice while you're hearing her speak. Faith is going to ring in your heart. And when it does, respond, move. When the Holy Spirit jumps in you, you jump up and you let that sound out. I just sent a book into Destiny Image, as a matter of fact, and there's a chapter on militant worship and a section called The Value of Volume. And you mentioned something there about the importance of lifting your voice, the importance of volume. When you said it, it seemed like it was coming from a depth of an understanding there. Can you talk to us about the importance of lifting our voice, practically speaking?
You know, I think that if you actually go back and you look at worship or praise being a weapon, if you go back and you look at actually the word shout, which is another way that we lift our voice, it says that we are to shout unto God with a voice of triumph. And then it says God arises amid shouts of praise. So whenever we start increasing the volume and we begin to shout in a place of victory, a place of triumph, it says God actually arises amid shouts of praise. It says God has gone up with a shout. And then it says, let God arise and his enemies be scattered. And so there is a direct correlation between God's people lifting up their voice, making a sound, releasing the volume in praise, in worship, in shouting, in a victorious, triumphant way that causes God to, we get God's attention. And when we shout, God stands up. Hmm. And when God stands up, his enemies are scattered. And we actually really started kind of pioneering this back in the late 1980s. And we were the crazy prophetic camp. But I'm telling you, when you came and you come to our worship times, our times of worship are not just self-focused. They're God-focused and they're victory-focused. And I believe that as we align our hearts, yes, God wants to touch us. God wants to meet with us. We want the glory of God to come. But out of that place of glory, there's a place of victory that God wants to release through us and to us. And we've seen time and time and time again, people getting saved, healed, delivered right there in the time of worship. We've watched things turn around. We've watched victories be released. We've watched prodigal children come back. We've watched finances shift. We've watched so many different miracles that have happened because the voice of the Lord goes forth, because we partner with it, with our praise and with our shout. And then we see God rise up and move on our behalf.
When we shout, God stands up. Hallelujah. Somebody let God stand up in your house right now and just shout hallelujah. Glory be to God. And the reason I think for this militarization of our praise and seemingly every facet of the body right now is being armed for victory and prepared for what's coming is because we are under an attack nationally and internationally. And we're seeing that. And it's been evident as far as masculinity being under attack in this nation. But something that goes underreported that we're now beginning to see with some of the movements that are taking place right now is womanhood is being attacked. It's being marginalized. It's being watered down, trivialized. This book, The Deborah Company, it's kind of a revived and expanded version of a revelation that you've been developing, and we'll put the link in the description of this video, for some time now. What made you re-release this book?
Well, you know, I had an encounter with the Lord. I wasn't really raised going to church. I wasn't raised to really know the Lord. I got saved when I was 14. I got filled with the Holy Spirit when I was 16. And so I wasn't churched, if you will. I wasn't raised up in a place where I knew the limitations that religion would put on women. And in the book, I detail the way that the enemy has worked overtime through the millennia to keep women silent. Hmm. And so I really believe that it is the time for women. But when I was 16 years old, I was praying in my room one day, and I was actually still in a Baptist church. God bless the Baptist. They laid a great, strong foundation and love for the word in my heart. But I'd been filled with the Holy Spirit. And the Lord spoke to me one day, and he said, "Jane, the plans that you've made for your life are not the plans I've made for your life." I was like, whoa, what is that? He said, instead of going to the college that you already have a scholarship and all your plans made, he said, "I'm going to send you to Bible college. And when you get there, you're going to meet a man, you're going to get married young, and I'm going to thrust you into ministry. And you'll travel the nations of the world. And sometimes he'll preach, and sometimes you'll preach, because I'm going to put my words in your mouth." And so I thought, if God was talking to me, then I could ask questions. I didn't know any rules. I didn't even know that he talked to people. So I just said, "Lord, can you show me what I'm going to be doing?" Because at that point, I'd been saved and in the church for 2 years, but I'd never seen women really do anything other than maybe be a nice pastor's wife, perhaps sing in the choir, or maybe teach Sunday school class, all of which are important. But I knew that God was calling me to something more. And I said, "Lord, can you show me somebody that's doing now what I'll be doing then?" And the Lord said this to me, and I think the year was 1977. He said, "There's nobody doing now what you'll be doing then, because I will be doing a new thing."
Wow.
And so I knew that God was going to do a new thing with women, but I was so excited that God had spoken to me. I went to my pastor, and I shared with him what the Lord said to me. And he put his arm around my shoulder and patted me and said, he said, "Girlie, I'm sorry to say that was not the voice of God."
No.
"Because women don't preach."
Oh.
And then I was actually asked to leave the church because of my wild radical ideas. And so I was actually raised in a family. My mom was an absolutely brilliant woman. And she studied in college and became a chemist, but she was oftentimes the only woman in her class. And professors would tell her, "You know, you don't, there's no reason for you to be in this class. You're just going to go home and have babies and never work in the field." And so I think my mom put inside of me, I had three brothers, and my mom put inside of me this sense of, you could be anything and do anything that you want. Don't let ever let somebody tell you you can't do something because you were born a woman. And sadly, the first time I ever got explicitly told I couldn't do something because I was a woman was when I got saved and came to church. Wow. How sad is that? Yeah. And so I really knew that God had something different for women. I, to be honest, I was never one of these people that loved women's meetings because back in the days that I was coming up, women's meetings were all about setting a table and arranging flowers. And I personally wanted to go change the world. Now I kind of wish I would have paid attention because I would love to learn how to arrange flowers, but I just was so hungry to change the world. And so I recognized that God was doing something different with women. And I realized that in this book, I actually take on some of the hard passages, such as "Let a woman keep silent in church" and the different things that have been used to really silence women. Because when you study them out in the original language, I don't believe that it's proper biblical ethics to say, "Well, that was then, this is now." Mm-hmm. I don't think that we need to update our Bible. But I do think that sometimes we need to go in and look at the original language to understand the author's intent. One scripture that really kind of emphasizes this is Psalms 68:11, which in the New King James will say, "The Lord gave the word, great was the company that published it." In the Amplified Bible, it says, "The Lord gave the word of power. Great was the company of women who bear and publish the word. They are a great army organized for war."
Wow.
It's a little bit different in your translation. It's just that the Bible translators really couldn't put you know, the emphasis on the woman there. Or in Proverbs 31, when we read about the virtuous woman, which is awesome. I mean, I want to be a virtuous woman by the definition of virtue, but the actual word that is used there is the exact same word that's translated every place else in scripture. When it refers to a man, it says it talks about valiant men. I think that the Bible translators just couldn't write the words, "Who can find a valiant woman?" And so really going into the word and going in and understanding the biblical text, understanding the context of that, because I started realizing that if a woman was actually supposed to keep completely silent, then she shouldn't be teaching Sunday school or singing in the choir. And then what did you do with all the other parts of the word where it encourages us to be a witness, where it encourages us to prophesy, where it encourages us to move in the gifts? I realized that God didn't just give spiritual gifts to men. He gave them to every person that was in the body of Christ. And so I began to realize that God had called me himself. Nobody told me that women weren't supposed to preach. And I had to, but I had to go into the word and really dig out the authority that God was giving to women in the word of God. And I actually found that 35% of the people that co-labored with Paul, that Paul commends in scripture, were women. He goes through and he gives a long list of women that co-labored with him in the gospel and that were used mightily in ministry in the first century church. And Paul actually commends these people, and 35% of them are actually women. And so I think that the church really kind of bought into a lie about what women could and could not do. And I think that now is the time that God is bringing a clarity about what his word actually says, so that he can bring women into a place of full function and fulfillment of their prophetic destiny.
Well, let's unpack that then for people who are watching, maybe new believers, they've come to the faith, and you see women prophesying in the New Testament. You see apostolic offices and giftings in the New Testament. But at the same time, it says a woman ought to keep silent in the church. What in the world does that verse mean contextually?
Well, there's a couple of different thoughts on that. One was that up until that point, women were not given any place in the Hebraic or Jewish community to learn the scriptures. Matter of fact, one of the first century rabbis, Rabbi Eleazar, said, I would rather the Torah be burned than to be entrusted into the mouth of a woman. Wow. I mean, they had some pretty prejudiced thought about women learning anything from the scripture. And so according to the culture of that day, women would sit separate from their husbands. The men would sit on one side or in the front, and the women would sit in the back. And the women were for the first time being taught or instructed in the scripture. And at times they would stop the service and they would ask questions. They would interrupt. And so when you actually take that word silence, does that word actually mean silence? Well, you study it out and you see how it's used every place else in scripture. And it actually does not mean silence, like lock your lips and don't ever say anything. But really what it says is it's translated every place else as quietness. Learn in quietness. In other words, start absorbing, start taking it in. It actually refers to men learning in quietness and learning in a place of absorbing and listening more than you're speaking. And so I think that one of the most liberating stories in scripture is when Mary and Martha, that whole story, and Martha was running around serving, and we've all heard the stories and the messages about don't be a Martha, be a Mary. Well, the truth is we need both. We need people to do the service, but Mary was sitting at Jesus' feet. And what you have to understand is that when Jesus made the statement, it says Mary has chosen the better part. What he was actually saying in that culture, which was completely radical, was, I approve of this woman sitting at my feet and learning, because that was completely taboo in the Jewish culture. Women were seen more as those that did what Martha did, the serving, the behind the scenes, the cooking of the food, the cleaning of the house, the doing all of that. And I don't have any problem with us being Marthas, but Jesus is saying to us, listen, I affirm your acts of service, but I'm saying you are first created to be a spirit being that is to learn of God and learn of the scriptures. And you really have to go all the way back to Genesis chapter 1 when you see that God made man and female in his image and in his likeness. He took woman from man, but it was actually the coming together of men and women that actually display to the world the full character, nature, and image of God. So I think that we're really living in a very exciting time right now. I am a submitted wife. You can ask my husband. we've been married for 41 years. We've been very happily married, and we co-labor in ministry together. My husband's a very strong person. And we work together as a team in ministry. As a wife, I'm submitted to him because I do believe that that's what scripture teaches. But really, the submission is a partnership that God has brought us into. And we know how to flow back and forth together. And we know how to honor each other's gifts and talents and abilities. And so I think that it really is an updating of an identity for women. Understanding women are not cursed. A lot of women believe, you know, well, because of the fall, because of the curse. No, God never cursed woman. He cursed the ground. He cursed the serpent. He said the woman was going to have, you know, some effects of the fall, which was going to be pain in childbirth, and the man would toil by the sweat of his brow. But men and women were not cursed. The ground was cursed and the serpent was cursed, but we actually remained the children of God. And God said to us, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. He didn't just say that to Adam. He said that to them, to Adam and Eve, and gave them the authority to go out and to begin to change the world.
That's so rich and so good. And men watching this, you say, well, what does that have to do with me? It has a whole lot to do with you. Because if you're called to protect the women in your life, you're called not just to protect them physically or to provide for them nutritionally, but to protect their identity and their purpose, their giftings, what God has called them to do. And so this book, you've said it, and I actually said it before you did, this is not just a book for women, this is a book for men. Why should men read this book?
Okay, well, my husband, Tom Hamon, he had an encounter with the Lord a number of years ago when the Lord just kind of started putting his hand in my back and pushing me forward. And I will say that I am who I am in ministry today because of my husband, who encouraged my gifts, and because of my father-in-law, Dr. Bill Hamon, who just put his hand in my back and said, go do what God's called you to do. Wow. And they've covered me. They've spoken into my life. They've let me know if I'm not coming across right, or if they felt like there was more that I had to give. But I remember one time my husband had this encounter with the Lord, and the Lord said to him, you know, at the end of your life, when you stand before me, I'm not just going to ask you to give an account for your own life, your own destiny, and for what I've called you to do, but I'm also going to ask you to give an account for whether or not you helped or hindered your wife and your children's destiny.
Wow.
He said, I'm going to hold you accountable. Did you help her or did you hinder her? Did you help them or did you hinder them in fulfilling the call and the destiny that I put upon their lives? And so he's been my biggest champion. My father-in-law, Dr. Bill Hamon, he's been one of my biggest champions. And I think that there's a whole generation of women that are out there that have lived under a really what I think amounts to a religious fake news, religious fake news. Listen, if I was the devil, I would try to figure out a way to shut down over 50% of the body of Christ from ever doing anything.
Yeah.
And that's what he's tried to do by lying to the church and telling them that women can't actually do anything except for what they do in the back rooms as Marthas. Very important role to be servants and to serve. And I believe that all of us should be, but also again, to release the voice of the women. This goes right back to what we started talking about, the voice war. The enemy wants to shut down your voice. He wants to shut down your ability to speak, to prophesy, to sing, to worship, and to be a voice of influence in your community and in the world.
Well, it's not just 50% of the church. Most people would say the active members in their church, the people who are really leading, 80% plus are women. What would happen if we activated all those sleeper cells within the church and let them begin to operate in their calling? Some would suggest that the whole conversation, women should keep silent in the church, was raised because in their newfound freedom, there was some breaches in protocol, and Paul was laying down some rules. And some people are concerned about breaches in protocol, and you go into that very in-depth in your book, and you talk about that. How do women and men, how do we make sure that as we step into this newfound freedom, that we're all operating, everything's decent and in order?
Right. I think a lot of people focus on the decent and in order part, and they forget the first part of that verse that says, let all things be done.
Come on.
So, we don't usually have to worry about decency and order until all things are being done.
That's
so
right.
we've led a prophetic church for 35 years, and I would say over 80% of our church can prophesy. Hmm. Does that mean that we have over 80% of our church prophesy every Sunday? No. We kind of direct traffic, if you will, but we expect everybody to be operating in the gifts that God has given to them. And so we have order, we have structure, We have hopefully a way that the Holy Spirit flow is not unhindered. We like to tell people that if you're going to prophesy or move in your gifts with other people, to try to, for the very best that you can, try to keep that under some kind of covering. In other words, don't just run around prophesying to each other without any place of accountability. We find that that protects the person that's being ministered to, as well as the person that's being, that's actually doing the ministering. Because we ask people to either have a witness or to actually record what is being said, because that's, you know, if somebody comes back to me and says, "Hey, well, you prophesied to me that I was supposed to divorce my husband and marry this other guy," I can say, "Where is that recorded?" Okay, because I can tell you that I didn't say that, but it's their word against mine. So having a witness, having some form of something recorded that can actually protect the person that's ministering, as well as make sure that the person that's receiving ministry can actually go back and listen to what God actually said. A really funny story. We were living in Southern California a number of years back, and my father-in-law came and ministered at a church. And a couple weeks later, I ran into a young lady that was at that conference, and she says, "Oh, do you remember me?" And I said, I don't really remember you. She says, "Well, I was at that conference and your father-in-law prophesied to me." And I'm thinking, well, he prophesied over a bunch of people. And he said, "No, you would remember me because I'm the one he prophesied was going to marry the pastor." And I thought, I would have definitely remembered that word. I said, "Do you actually have a recording of that?" She says, "I do. And I've actually written it all down," which is also what we recommend. And so she went and she got me the sheet of paper of the prophecy. And I read the whole prophecy and I didn't see anything in there about her marrying the pastor. And I said, "I'm sorry, I don't see." And she goes, "Well, it's right here." She pointed to a line that said, "And the Lord says, I'm going to give you the desires of your heart." So we call those visions, okay? wishful thinking and calling it a vision. But that's a good example of why we record things, why we have things witnessed, why that we keep it under a certain protocol, that especially in the church. Now, if you're out in the world ministering to your waitress or ministering to somebody in the store, obviously that's maybe not always the case, but especially in the church, I think it's a good safeguard to lay down some protocols, and that helps to facilitate all things being done, but then brings in decency and order.
That's why the book is so good for everyone, regardless of your gender or where you are, because it has stuff in there that can benefit the whole body. But and I want all of you women to get ready, because this book would make, by the way, an amazing Bible study for your women's group, life groups. It would be transformative. You need to get a copy. The link is in the description of this video. Get a hold of it and begin to dig into it. You start to talk about an entire section in your book about Deborah, the wife, and living a balanced life. Now, listen, I am not a woman, but I know some. And I'm married to one, I'm father to one, and I know that women run the world, by the way. They're keeping everything together. Behind every great man is a woman, great woman, but behind every great woman is a great man. But they struggle with balance. They struggle with keeping everything together because they're spinning so many plates. I can focus on one thing at one time. My wife provides me the luxury of doing that by spinning all of the other plates at the same time. So how do we find that Deborah-like balance? Maybe talk about Deborah a little bit and how she was both a prophetess and a wife.
Yeah, so in my book, I actually break this down into five different sections. I talk about how she was a prophet, which was that part in the nation at that time. You have to remember that they didn't have prophetic people. The Holy Spirit hadn't yet been poured out. So it was only a prophet here or a prophet there that actually spoke for God. So she was one that God had assigned and appointed to speak his heart, his will, and his mind to the people of Israel at that time. She was a prophet. She was also a judge, which was the governmental positioning in the land at that time. It was the senior executive position, like being the president or the prime minister over Israel at that time. So she was both a prophet and a judge. She was a wife. She was called the mother. She was called the wife of Barak. She was called the mother, a mother in Zion. She was a warrior. She went right out on the battlefield, and she was a worshiper. And I think that these are the characteristics of the Deborah Company that God is raising up. And I know that might sound like a lot, but I think what the Lord is saying is that I think that in our pursuit of fulfilling a call of God, we have to understand that in the midst of that call of God, one of the greatest callings that we will ever have is to be wife to our husband and mother to our children. And that doesn't preclude you or exclude you from anything else.
Yes.
But I have in my over 40 years of ministry, I have watched women do one of two things. Number one, they might say, well, I can't fulfill the call of God because I have children at home right now. And so I'll do that later. I'll do that later at some other point in my life. And so they basically take a step back from the call of God on their life. When I first launched into ministry, my husband and I have been pastoring this church for 35 years now, and we have been co-pastors the entire 35 years of that time. I had a three-year-old, a not quite two-year-old, and a month-old child at that time. So I had my hands filled with mamahood, and yet at the same time, I also knew that there was a call of God on my life. And so I knew that I had to find a place of balance between taking care of my family and tending to the call of God. And I had to realize one day I was praying to the Lord, and the Lord said, Jane, don't you think I knew you were going to have children when I called you? And I was like, yes, God knows all these things. So I said, so there must be some way that I can find this amazing place of balance. And so, but I've seen also women do something else, is that I've seen them basically go after their call, or go after, let's be real, going after a job or a business or a secular endeavor or the call of God. Okay. Anything that women are now coming into, and they leave their family behind, and they end up losing their family because they didn't prioritize their family. And so I think that throughout my kids' upbringing, there was always a tension between time spent with my family and my children and time spent where I was answering the call of God. And so one day I was, my husband and I were on vacation, and I was at the top of a mountain skiing. And anybody that's ever skied knows that the way that you do not want to ski is you don't put your ski tips down mountain and push and put equal pressure on both skis. Okay. And the Lord started talking to me as I was skiing, and he was saying, listen, it's like one ski is the ski of ministry and calling. The other ski is the ski of family. And you go back and forth, you ebb and flow, you make turns. And then as you're making a turn going down the mountain, you put all of your weight on the downhill ski. So there's going to be times when you're putting all of your weight on the ski of ministry, but then you're going to turn the corner and put all of your weight on the ski of family. And so always having that sense in your heart of prioritizing your family, but also understanding that you've got to be obedient to the call of God. The first time I answered the call to go on a ministry trip overseas, it was going to be a 3-week trip, and I was going to go, and my husband was going to stay. And I knew that's what the Lord had said to me, but it just didn't feel like what a good mom should do. And, but the Lord had spoken to me and told me to go. And my husband was very supportive. He was like, babe, you know, I've got this, you know. And I'm thinking, okay, my kids aren't going to get a shower for 3 weeks. My kids are going to eat popcorn and pizza for 3 weeks. I mean, what kind of a mother leaves her kids with their dad for 3 whole weeks? Okay.
It's terrible.
It's terrifying. I mean, even thinking of it now, I was thinking, what was I thinking? And I was pretty much just about talked myself out of going on this trip. And one day, as I was praying, the Lord said to me, he said, you know, Jane, he said, you think that somehow your kids are going to be harmed if you obey me. And I was like, oh, that's really... You don't play fair, God. Okay. And he said, well, actually, if you decide not to go on this trip, he said, what you will have taught your children through your example is that when God speaks, you get to decide whether or not to obey. Isn't it better for you to obey me and set an example of obedience for your children? Because that will keep them all of their lives.
Wow.
And I want you to know that my kids have all been to the nations, and they've all prioritized God. And now that they're adults, they still love me, they still love God, and they still love the church. So I, you know, somewhere along the line, that example of obedience, I think, stuck in their hearts.
As you're sharing, I just kind of sense in my spirit that there's women watching this with tears in their eyes right now saying, yes, God, I want to do that. We've got more to discuss. This interview is not even close to over, but would you pray for them right now? I think they're just hungry. They're ready to receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation to show them how to move forward in this thing.
Yes. Well, Father, I pray for my sisters right now, Lord, those that have every single one of them having a call of God on their lives, maybe not to do what I do, but to do what you've called them to do. And I pray right now, God, I break every yoke of shame, every yoke of condemnation, every religious spirit that has tried to push back against them to try to keep them out of obeying God. And I thank you today is a day of freedom for them. A day of joy, recognizing, Lord, that you've put your hand on their lives for good. And Lord, that whether they're that mom that's home with small children, Lord, you've got a work of intercession for them to do. You've got a work of service for them to do. You've got a work of training their giftings, their callings, their ability, putting a vision in their heart, Father God. Lord, if there are women that are watching, that their children are grown and they found themselves just a little bit lost, Lord, because they poured everything in to being a wife and a mom. Lord, I thank you, God, that they're realizing that you've brought them to the kingdom for such a time as this. And Lord, that now is the time, now is the hour, Father God, for women to begin to take their place alongside the men, alongside our brothers in the body of Christ, Lord, to do a work for your kingdom, to teach the word, to minister the gospel to the lost, to bring healing to the sick and deliverance to the captive. Lord, I thank you, Father, that every woman is coming into a recognition and a realization, God, that they've been called to the kingdom for this time and for more than what they even imagined. God, maybe my sisters are in the workplace, they're in the corporate world, or they're out there, God, serving in some other capacity as a teacher or in a store or some. Lord, I thank you, Father God, that they are not going to be defined just by their vocation, but they are going to be defined by the calling and the identity that you have put on each and every one of their lives. And I just feel like the Lord is just saying, just say yes. You don't have to have everything figured out. You don't have to have, but what about this? What about that? I certainly went through those years. How does this all going to work, Lord? Just say yes. God is looking for your yes today, and he's going to work everything out to bring you into your time of fullness.
Hallelujah. Would you just write in the comments, yes. If that's you, if she's ministered to you, write yes. I believe the Spirit of God's moving on you right now, right there where you are. Receive this word and receive this anointing that he's releasing into your life. And you share in the book, one of the keys to operating in this Deborah company is found in the name itself, in Deborah's name. What does her name mean, and what can we glean from it?
Well, Deborah's name actually means the bee. Like the little honeybee. Bzz. And it's really fascinating when you study out the life of a bee. A bee is obviously a very industrious worker. That's where you have worker bees. And they live in community. They live in community with other bees, and they all set their mind to a singular purpose. They are those that cross-pollinate, that go out and they take the nectar from one stem to the next, and there's a cross-pollination effect. But I love the story of a new bee as it's coming forth, and it's like as it's coming out of the cell that it's grown in from the larva stage up until the time it's for the birth of the bee, it's got a kind of struggle. It's got a struggle, and it's got a push, and it's got a press to get out of that cell. And if we understand that what the struggle actually does is it's not a bad thing, it's a good thing, because in the struggle, there's a membrane around the wing of the bee that gets rubbed off so that as soon as the bee emerges, the bee can spread its wings and fly. And so some of you might feel like you've been in a struggle for your life, a struggle for your destiny. I know that what the enemy loves to do is get us into a place of survival. And the Lord wants to bring you out of survival into a place of thriving, into a place where you can actually spread your wings and fly. Women that are watching right now, chances are that you've endured some form of physical, emotional, or sexual abuse from the world, and possibly even some of those abusive, constraining things in the church. And I just believe the Lord is saying that's part of your struggle, but that it's not to limit you or define you, that it is actually that where God takes the curse and turns it into a blessing for you and even releases you out of that. And the very way that God brings you into wholeness and freedom, because Jesus has wholeness and freedom for you, you're not a victim. You can be a victor in Christ no matter what you've gone through. God can cause you to be a victor, and God can cause you to be a whole person in your heart, in your soul, in your mind. And I believe that God is saying that all the struggle that you've been through is actually producing something that is going to cause you to actually spread your wings and fly. The very difficult things that you've been through. I love in Genesis, it says what the enemy meant for evil, God has turned for good. And I believe that many of you are going to find that the very things that God has brought you out of, God has now made you a minister to help bring freedom and deliverance and wholeness to others.
There's so much meat here. You guys can tell by listening to this that it's just scratching the surface. This is all in the book, The Deborah Company, and there's more in the book. In fact, in a moment, I'm going to ask you, we often talk about the last Adam. I want to ask you about the mystery of the last Eve. I want to talk about that in a second. But before we do that, ladies and gentlemen, listen, this is a powerful anointing. I mentioned to her before the broadcast, I really felt like that when we were preparing for this, the Lord said, this is big. This is huge. Something is being released into your life. And what we want to do is we want to sow into her anointing. We want to sow into this Deborah Company anointing and into her ministry. If you'd like to partner with us to do that, go to encountertoday.com and give us unto the Lord. Whatever he tells you to do, you do it. Take advantage of the special offer. We have resources we'll send you just as our gift to you to thank you for partnering with us to sow into this great ministry. That's encountertoday.com. And Sister Jan, I want to talk to you now about the last Eve. This was something that maybe I'd heard this, but it really just opened my eyes. And I don't think I'll ever forget this ever again after you shared this in the book. Talk to us about that.
So the scripture talks to us about the first Adam.
Yes.
Which was, we all know Adam, and the sin that set humanity into a place of being separated or distanced from God. But then in the New Testament, it tells us that just as there was a first Adam, there's a last Adam, and we know that that was Christ. And just as by one man's disobedience, all were made sinners, by one man's obedience, many were made righteous. And of course, that's speaking of Christ. And just as Eve was the bride of Adam, so I believe the modern day church is the bride of Christ. And that we need to understand that just as the first Adam fell and there was a second Adam that redeemed, there was a first Eve that fell, and there is a second Eve that I believe will fulfill the prophecy that was written in Genesis chapter 3, where it says the woman, that the enemy might bruise the woman's heel, but she's going to crush his head. And I don't believe that it's just speaking about a woman. I believe it's speaking about the bride of Christ, the church. Now, for any gentlemen that are watching today, I know that you may have a little bit of a challenge thinking of yourself as the bride of Christ, but we women always have to think of ourselves also as sons and daughters of God. So when the Bible talks about sons of God, we know that we're grafted into that. And so the men have to understand that they're also grafted in as members of the last Eve, the church, the bride that is going to be without spot, without wrinkle, without any such thing. God's bringing the church, the ecclesia, into a place of beauty, into a place of perfection, into a place of wholeness, and into a place where we become the reflection of our groom, Jesus Christ. And as we reflect the love and the beauty and the glory of God into the earth, we understand that that will set the course for the last day's harvest, and that God's going to partner with his bride, the last Eve, to crush the head of the enemy.
Wow. The book is The Deborah Company, and this has been the surprise book of the year, as well as the surprise interview of the year, as far as how it's impacted me, and I think it's having the same impact on our audience. Sister Jane Hamon, thank you so much for being with us on Encounter today.
It has really been my pleasure. Thank you so much, Alan.
I have so many more questions for you, which is why we're going to hop over to the podcast just for a few minutes and talk about what the Spirit of God is saying about the season that we're in right now. We'll see you over there. All of you that have been joining with us, make sure you hit the thumbs up button. Make sure you share this. Come on. Every man, every woman you know needs to hear what we talked about, and you need to get a copy of the book right now. Don't wait to do it. You'll forget. do it right now. Go into the description of the video, hit the link, go buy a copy of the book, and you'll be glad that you did. We'll see you over in Encounter Underground or next time right here on Encounter Today.